Hi everyone, so today I'm gonna teach you guys how to turn a mesh into a spline. T-spline's a mesh. So create an image like this one. If you're wondering how it kind of looks like that, like with the transparent thing, it's actually more of a viewport thing and not really like Photoshop or anything, and maybe I can give you guys that viewport design capture file as well. So let's get started. So I'm probably not gonna teach you guys how to make the actual mesh, because everyone would probably come up with like a different mesh structure, but it would like, you know, make everything kind of look like this thing. So what I was talking about before, it's a display mode, which is kind of like a capture thing, so like, you know, it'll come out like this in like wireframe, and that in like rendered, which is still looks pretty good. I just really like this kind of ghosted blueprint one, so you can kind of like see through with the transparency. So like, you know, creates that thing. I can probably just give you this file, but as I said, everyone will probably come up with a different type of mesh, so you can apply it to like any mesh that you have. So this is kind of like my mesh definition. This is just like a test, really. I don't really know what I'm gonna do with this yet. So I'm just like changing the values of that. This could probably also help with the surface design task, so maybe I should just upload this. Like that, and I probably, let's just make a mesh. I might just like make that a bit more lower. Looking a bit sorry, let me just increase this mesh. There you go, that's looking a lot better. I just want maybe probably like, let's try 10 holes. Let me match that output there, and splash, connect the rest of the outputs here. Yep, so I got them holes. With these tiny holes here, that's when you triangulate the mesh later. So the more of your mesh UV values that you have, that will be like this area here. With the constructed mesh, so you have to have Weaverbird. Just do mesh join first, to make sure that all of these are just like one smooth mesh. Just gonna flatten that data, probably gonna turn off that preview. Then you have to weld the vertices together, so instead of like multiple faces, I don't really know how to explain that, unless you like, you can grab some panels. So there's 576 vertices here, and coming out here there's 482, and that's because it's welding all the vertices that are probably like duplicating. So I'm gonna flatten that data as well, so it's all in one separate list. And then this is when Weaverbird comes in. So you have to find a Weaverbird picture frame. Let me just turn off these previews again, so they're not clashing and you can see what each one is. So mesh to mesh. So Weaverbird frame gives you the edges. This could probably help with fabrication as well, because you've got the separate segments there, what's coming up there is now you've got 2,300, 2,322 faces. So that's like each one of these there. That's way too much probably. So like if I was gonna fabricate this, maybe join all of these faces together so it's one smooth face, find that middle line, probably flatten this, laser cut it, and then also put in that middle line so, and put it like as a scored or like sorry not scored etched line so that it can fold, but I'd probably try it with like a smaller mesh because 2,322 faces is just like insane. Maybe if we're doing it as a whole class group kind of project, then it might just be possible. Yeah, so after Weaverbird frame, oh, there's also the distance thing here. So it's set on 5. You can make that bigger or smaller depending on what you decide. So let's just show it. Yeah, so there, you know, oh, this might help with some of the people that are doing the wooden frames one. Yeah, so probably look into this. Let's just keep trying this one. Oh yeah, cool, that's like looking real cool. Probably gonna set that max to 40 because don't want too big of a value. So might just stick with this one. Okay, so after Weaverbird frame, you want Weaverbird thicken. Weaverbird mesh thicken. So put that in there as well. Yeah. So what we're getting is now like cut. It's looking a lot more 3D now. So that value is also set on 5. So I would probably change that up as well. Okay. Yeah. So you've got that thickness. Gonna put that there. Sorry. I'm just gonna change that song. Yeah. So now you've got like an actual thicker mesh here as well. And then just out of interest, just gonna increase that and see how that's gonna turn out. So the next component. Let me just turn off that preview. Is to use Weaverbird Catmull Clark. Catmull Clark? Okay, Catmull Clark. So that's a formula. I'm not gonna try and explain that, how it works. And like the formula behind it, it's a bit hard to like get that right in terms of like explaining, but you've got all of it here in this subdivision thing. So I guess you could like probably play around with this for the sake of like getting different iterations. I don't know if you have that much time left to do that, but might be a good way to research for part C. But also, like, yeah, we'll just continue with this one. You input that one. So it's starting to form those kind of holes that you see in the spline. But you're getting a lot of these, like, vertices and, like, sharper edges. And if that's what you kind of want for your one, then that's, like, completely fine. Just, like, bake this one. But that's not what we want. You could smooth it. Wait, is it on 1 already? Oh yeah, well, it's already smooth. Let's try 2. No, I'm not really seeing that difference. Probably later. Yeah, okay, so the final segment that you have to use is Weaver Bird Loop, which kind of just like nicely ties everything together. Oops, lop. Loop subdivision. Yeah, so let me input that. You've got now a smoother mesh. It probably has more faces than the Catmull Clark, but it is a lot smoother. Yep. So you can see that. It's looking very, I'm not really like into this kind of design aesthetic, but if you're like looking into biomimicry, I feel like that this would help quite a bit. So all you have to do now is just like bake that. Bake it. And there you go. You've got a T-splined mesh. That actually looks quite cool there. Yeah, so maybe if we like lessen that mesh UV here, I'll just show you. So if I just go like there, bring it like a lot lesser. Yeah, and then probably change up this populated geometry to like maybe 6. Just want to show you guys how this is like looking at. I'm not really going to change this. You don't necessarily need to change this component here. That's only if like you want like more holes. Just gonna change these distances probably. There you go. That's the thickness of this. Like, you know, if I bring that insane ass thickness there. And then it's just a bit too much on one side. Okay, yeah. Ooh, nice. So if I bake that one as well. And then you've got this one. So this might be useful for like, you know, infills to maybe a frame. It all depends on the mesh that you're creating. You could even use it for like the Vessoir cloud, the lava void, since a lot of it is meshes, or like are meshes, sorry. Just like view capture to file that, probably. So you could see, so if you capture the file, browse, make sure that it's PNG, transparent background, so you can like, you know, change up the background later. Spline 2. You can change up that resolution, make it bigger if you want, like 3,540 to 2,580 or something. So that's like a lot more bigger, a lot more clearer when you put it in your InDesign. It'll just be like a bigger file. So spline 2. Yep. So it's coming off as black background because that's a PNG. I always try and save everything as PNGs. It just makes everything a lot more nicer. So what I'm talking about with like that PNG file format. So with JPEG, it kind of saves like whatever's in the background. Let me just start up Illustrator here. It's taking quite a bit. A lot of things running up. Okay, so if I were to just maybe set a background here. If you're working Illustrator, it's probably best to do backgrounds as well. Layers, set layers as well. Let's go with like that crazy orange. And then put your image on top, just so you can like have some leeway in terms of like viewing, and it's just easier to move things if you lock the layers and you don't have to like try and select everything, which is just, that's just really hard when you've got so many files going on. So if I just put that spline and this other spline mesh, so it's making that insanely cool thing there. It's pretty cool. I like it. I like it a lot. Yeah. So there's that there. Then there's this one here. Like, you know, if I set another background thing here behind it, let's just call it B2. Set another color there. Let's go with like this weird ass green. Yeah, so if I just put that, it's there behind, the orange is still on top. If I just change that, and then you've got like that change background. So hopefully this helps you guys out with your final presentation and just like, you know, general graphics and everything. Good luck with all of your group work, and I'll see you guys on Tuesday.